I stand at my kitchen sink, stirring vegetable soup. Down and around goes the ladle, till the vegetables swirl, and I skim a coating of oil from the top, while greasy Joan doth keel the pot. Where did that come from, I wonder? Who's Joan? And what does keel mean? Steam, redolent of tomato and onion, floats past my face. I grind in pepper, add thyme and basil, stirring carefully so the pot doesn't brim over. To wit, to woo, while greasy Joan doth keel. To wit, to woo, scraps of words from I know not where. It doesn't matter exactly who Joan is or was, I decide. She's every woman who ever toiled over a cooking pot, which is a lot of women. And greasy Joan, hey, Mom, calls my son. Can you come sign this stuff for my English class? Sure, let me get to a stopping place. We got our reading list for this semester. English class in high school means literature, with a capital L. And literature means one's acquaintance with Shakespeare is no longer left up to chance. One is officially introduced. As to an eccentric great uncle who might bequeath you some fortune, and for whom you dress up and present yourself in the formal living room. Ninth grade, Romeo and Juliet. A great tragedy of star-crossed love, our teacher says. Ha, we know about love, its groping and its urgencies. Are we expected to remove our attention from the real issues of love, like who's going to homecoming and who went parking over the weekend, and focus instead on columns of heavily annotated text in Perspectives on Literature? Please. In the classroom, we fidget, called up one by one to recite our memorized passages. Sherry Lee, head JV cheerleader, eases a lock of hair behind her shoulder and breathes, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo? Billy Zachary edges to the front of the room and mutters, but soft what light through yonder window breaks, it is the east and Juliet is the sun. That summer, at 14, I slouch in an auditorium seat in Lake Charles, Louisiana, waiting to see my first Shakespeare play. Students at the Governor's Program for Gifted Children are staging The Tempest. The director, that white kid with a fro who just rushed back to the lighting booth, is barely older than the actors, a local boy named Tony Kushner, home for the summer from college in New York. I'm not expecting much fun. Shakespeare sounds kind of heavy. Then the curtain rises onto a bright tumble of movement. Barefoot teenagers in slickers dash around stage, climbing up and down the rigging of a makeshift ship and shouting to one another about a coming storm. From the first pelting of water onto the stage to Prospero's last misty blessing, I'm mesmerized. Oh, brave new world that has such people in it. 10th grade means Julius Caesar. The boys in our class are happier. There's war and death, more politics and less love. In 11th grade with Macbeth, things get better yet. Witches, murder, depravity. About as good as anything on Dark Shadows or Night Gallery. Finally, between my class and college stretches the gauntlet of our senior year, guarded by the looming figure of Mrs. Hansel B. O'Quinn, the 12th grade English teacher. My brother has paved the way for me with Mrs. O'Quinn, as older siblings so often kindly do. 5 years earlier, he asked if he could earn extra credit in her class by submitting, his words, a report on reincarnation with you and Queen Victoria as the prime example. I have trouble not thinking of this as I watch Miss O'Quinn in her brocaded suit dress, enthroned on her wooden stool in English 4, her hair upswept from her pale forehead, her blue eyes glinting like frost. Her wooden pointer leads us, scepter-like, through Hamlet's gnarly syllables. Oh, that this too solid flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew. When Gloucester's eyes are gouged out and cling leer, she reigns calmly over our squealing and retching. Thankfully, such high drama is not the stuff of my life tonight, a soup supper on an ordinary Tuesday. After we eat, I call to my son, who has scuttled back to the living room. I can look over those papers now. Can we do it later? I'm kind of busy. There's glee in his voice. Busy with homework? Not exactly. He stretched out on the couch, laughing over his iPhone, his face alight with the latest news from his friends, clearly in another world. So I go to check my own messages. New in my inbox is an email from one of my college roommates, titled, "Was the Hope Drunk?" Now, this is puzzling. Greta doesn't usually refer to me with an article. And she does usually capitalize my name. As to her question, I can't think of a time, in recent memory at least, when she would need to inquire into my sobriety, or lack thereof. A click of the mouse clears things up. "Was the Hope drunk?" writes Greta, a line from Macbeth. My Riverside edition has those words circled with a note saying, "Hi, Gret." Dana found it while reading my Riverside. She feels sure Hope marked my book. I fear she must be right. I remember college Shakespeare, turning the tissue-thin pages of the plays in English 12, poring over the sonnets in English 10, stunned by their range, their virtuosity, their heartbreak. However, I have no memory of scrawling a note in Greta's Shakespeare 33 years ago. How little I imagined picking up a pencil to leave my marginally witty note that it would one day surprise not just Greta, but her teenage daughter in a then faraway future, not to mention 52-year-old me. Hi. When I plop down on the couch to tell my son about the email, he nods and agrees. That's funny. So, Greta's daughter's reading Macbeth. I pick up the packet from his English teacher. What about you guys? What's next for you? Julius Caesar, says my son. It's about these people in ancient Rome. According to some of the juniors who read it last year, it's actually pretty good. Back at the sink, the soup pot is in soak. Hot water, a squirt of soap, and I scrub and turn it bottom up as a storm gale might keel a ship, capsizing it into enchantment. Still, who in the world is Joan? Then it hits me. 9. I'm lying on my bed, reading in the house by the bayou. The book, an anthology of children's poetry, is packed with poems divided into topics like playtime, pets, and holidays. I read rollicking metrics about animal crackers and cocoa, and free verse poems about fog and goblins. I lie on my right side, face propped on fist, until that hand tingles and I switch to the left and read on. Outside, cicadas clamor. A greenish light filtered through cypress trees slowly fills my room. Sprinkled throughout the book are a few poems that don't quite fit in. Their words and rhythms are enticingly off-kilter. "Full fathom five thy father lies. Where the bee sucks, there suck I." The name under these verses is William Shakespeare, whom I know from cartoons to be a man in tights, a ruffled collar, and shorts shaped like a pincushion. In the section on seasons, this Shakespeare has a little song about winter. No snowmen and mittens here. This winter time is raw and chapped and peculiar. When icicles hang by the wall, and Dick the shepherd blows his nail, and Tom bears logs into the hall, and milk comes frozen home in pail. When blood is nipped and ways be foul, then nightly sings the staring owl, to whit, to woo, a merry note, while greasy Joan doth keel the pot. So there she is. I, at 9, have never seen an icicle, and I don't know who these people are. But the frumpy comfort of the scene, the chilly air in that kitchen becomes instantly real. As she still is, greasy Joan and grungy me, soup splashed and oil smudged, bound across 4 centuries by our common chore. Many tomorrows have crept by, some weary, stale, flat, and unprofitable, some inlaid with patterns of bright gold. My high school classmate, Billy Zachary, died young. But Sherry Lee is alive, I believe, and might yet friend me on Facebook. The earth has bubbles, as the water has, and these are of them. Whither are they vanished? Some things never change, I think, hanging up the dish towel and turning off the light. Today, I can Google Shakespeare's quotes and call up his tragedies and romances on the palm of my hand. But high school still unfolds in mundane majesty, from Romeo and Juliet to Hamlet, and certain off-kilter poetry still laces my thoughts and sends a delicious shiver up my spine.